Very good morning, everyone. I'm Rashmi P. Mandi, a student of Karnataka State Law University's Law School. And on behalf of Karnataka State Law University, it gives me immense pleasure to welcome all the dignitaries and participants for the one-week faculty development program on the law and vulnerable. Now, with great honor, may I introduce Professor Dr. Subir K. Bhatnagar, Vice Chancellor of Ram Manohar Lohia National Law University, Lucknow. Sir has completed his LLM from Kurukshetra University and PhD in law from Rohtak University, Haryana. He has served for almost four decades as a law teacher in various university departments. He was also the member of the first academic council of the National Law School of India University, Bengaluru in the year 1987. He has been nominated by the Chief Justice of India as the member of the Executive Council of the Indian Law Institute in 2006. Sir has worked in various capacities at the Babasaheb Bhimrao Ambedkar University, Lucknow. Some of the major positions which he has held are the Dean of Law and the Acting Vice Chancellor of the Babasaheb Bhimrao Ambedkar University, Lucknow in 2001 and 2007. Based on his long teaching and research experience, he has served as the member of academic bodies in many academic bodies and institutions of national repute. So to name a few, he was a part of the National Law University, Assam National Law University, and Himachal Pradesh National Law University and other universities at Delhi, Assam, Jammu, Patna, West Bengal, Haryana, Uttarakhand, and also Gujarat. Sir has published around three dozen papers and in reputed national journals, and he has edited a number of books also. He has been a member of the editorial and advisory boards of various reputed law journals. Apart from there, he has been invited by the All India Radio to deliver several talks on the legal and other issues. His special areas of interest include constitutional law, jurisprudence, human rights, and legal aid. It is an honor to have you with us today, sir. I extend a very warm welcome to you for the session. I also extend a hearty welcome to Professor Dr. P. Ishwar Bhatt, Honorable Vice Chancellor of Karnataka State Law University. I would also like to extend a hearty welcome to Major Siddhalingaya S. Hiremath, KAS, Registrar of Karnataka State Law University, and to Professor Dr. C. S. Patil, Dean Faculty of Law, and Professor Dr. G. B. Patil, Registrar Evaluation of Karnataka State Law University. I extend a warm and a hearty welcome to Professor Dr. Ratna R. Bharamgowda, Director of the Faculty Development Program on the Law and Vulnerable, and as well as the Professor of Law at Karnataka State Law University. And I heartily welcome all the participants for the session. Now, may I request Professor Dr. Subir K. Bhatnagar to kindly enlighten us. Please, sir.
Thank you very much for inviting me to deliver a lecture in your very prestigious FDP. I am grateful to Professor Ishwar Bhatt, Professor Ratna and other colleagues in the KSLU. The topic which is given to me relates to the rights of sexual minorities. The first question is why we are thinking about the rights of the sexual minorities. That is, to Section 377 of the Indian Penal Code and the NALSA judgment. But why it is so that under 377, the sexual minorities were punished? It is still there after Naftes. It has been diluted in Naftes case. So we will have to go back to the basic question. Between law and morality, that is relationship between law and morality. And the question is whether law can be used to enforce the moral perceptions of the society. Just before the adoption of Indian Penal Code in 1860 in India, John Stuart Mill in 1859 propounded that the society has no right to enforce its moral perceptions unless and until where their violation would not cause objective perceptible harm. This is known as harm principle. If the activities of the certain sections of the society are likely to cause harm to others, then that activity can be addressed by law. But what is harm? What kind of harm? So he says, John Stuart Mill, it should be objectively perceptible harm, not emotional or feeling. The harm based on emotions or feelings. It can be caused through some objective methodology. So he uses the term very carefully, qualifies the term harm with objectively perceptible harm. And then he goes on further to say that diversity in the society is a positive factor. If you do not allow it, then the majority will enforce its moral propositions, perceptions, and that may amount to moral repression of the minorities in that particular polity or society. This is a basic question: what constitutes harm? Then we will discuss that also. After 100 years of his proposition given in 1859, this debate about the relationship between law and morality, or you can say the legal enforcement of morals, again arose in the United Kingdom. And the occasion was the publication of the report of the Wolfenden Committee. Wolfenden Committee was constituted in the United Kingdom to look into the issues relating to homosexuality and prostitution, whether they should be decriminalized or not. Now, I will be focusing on homosexuality. The committee recommended that the male homosexuality between two consenting adults should not be criminal. Now, this point was taken by Lord Devlin. And from here started Hart Devlin controversy, or debate, you can say. Devlin delivered Machiavellian lectures in 1958, which were published in his book titled Enforcement of Morals in 1965. He took an exception to the supporting argument of Wolfenden Committee, that is, supporting that the homosexuality should not be criminal, because report had applied Millesian principle, that is the principle given by John Stuart Mill, that is the harm principle, arguing that there are private areas of morality which law should not touch. That was the basis of Wolfenden Committee report, that there are certain private areas of morality which law should not touch. That's why it recommended that this homosexuality, male homosexuality between two consenting adults in private, should be decriminalized. Now, Devlin opposes this kind of reasoning, and he builds up his own theory of morality. He says that the society rests upon shared morality, which is a seamless web. That is, all of us live in a society, there are some shared features of the society. It may be religion, it may be language, it may be culture, but it is morality also. So he says that we share a morality, that is shared morality, and it is seamless. That is, it is not like a confined web. It is open-ended, you can say. And this morality can be legally defended, as we defend our constitution, as we defend our territorial integrity. Any action which is going against our territorial action, we call it subversive action, because that will destroy the integrity of the nation. You can say geography. Land. The nation has a geography also, that land also. So that is to be countered. Likewise, we have morality also, and it should also be legally defended. And then he says, and that is the most important point which came into debate when Hart joined. He argued, Lord Devlin, that if there is a threat to the moral structure of the society, and which is felt to be intolerable, that is any kind of a threat to the moral structure of society, which the society thinks that it is or feels that it is intolerable, that may be disgusting, repulsive, distastefulness, maybe hatred also. It's a feeling. It is intolerable. It cannot be tolerated. It may not be objective tolerance. It may be subjective also. Whereas John Stuart Mill is talking about objectively perceptible harm. Devlin is not talking about that objectively perceptible intolerance. He's talking about felt by the society. Then whose morality? Whose intolerance? So he gives an idea of jury box morality. The person who is standing in the jury box. Or you can say, he again uses the term average right-minded citizen. His morality is the morality of the society or the polity. He accepts, Lord Devlin accepts, that there is a political potential tension between two things. What? Public demands of society. These public demands of society are addressed through or communicated through the moral perceptions of the society. These are the public demands of decency, manners, etiquettes, and moral behavior. Whereas on the other side, you find private inclinations. Maybe that under Hindu marriage law, monogamy is allowed, but there may be a private inclination to break it. So public demand among Hindus is to be monogamous, whereas the private inclination is to go, beyond it. So there is a tension, potential tension, always in the society between the public demands of the society, which it wants to enforce through morality, and the private inclinations of the persons or citizens, you can say, there is a tension. Now, how a balance can be struck? So Devlin says that he agrees to it, that there should be maximum freedom to the citizens, but that should be compatible with the social integrity. That should be compatible with the social integrity, and social integrity is based on the shared morality. So again, he comes back to the same point. Then he says that law should be slow to change the moral stance. That is, law should not be very quick in dealing or in changing the moral perceptions or moral stance of the society. It takes time. Let the society change, and then you register the change in your law. So law should not be the leader to bring moral change in the society. So it should be very slow. He is not saying it cannot do that, but it should be, because he is asking for that, but it should be slow. And then thirdly, he says that the privacy should be respected to the greatest possible extent. Again, he is putting a limit to it. Now, against this, Hart comes with a proposition. And then that is published in Law, Liberty, and Morality. He denounces the moralism of legislature, moralism of the judiciary. 377 IPC is an example of legislative moralism. But he takes on judicial moralism also, and he cites that case of 1774, that is Jones versus Rendell, when Lord Mansfield, please mind it, that is a very crucial point, Lord Mansfield had said in 1774 that the court sits here as a journal censor and guardian of public manners. The court sits here as a censor, journal censor, and guardian also of what? Of the public manners. So this is denounced as judicial moralism, and Hart opposes both of them, the legislative moralism and judicial moralism. He cites another case also in his book, that is Shaw versus DPP, Director of Public Prosecutions, that is known as Lady Directory's case, where a person had published the names, addresses, and the services given by the prostitutes in the United Kingdom, in London. So that was known as Lady Directory's case. Now he was prosecuted. There was no statutory offense. There was no offense given in the book of the law, in the penal code. Even then, he was charged and prosecuted, and that was upheld also. And that charge was conspiracy to corrupt public morals. This was not legislative action. This was judicial action. They created an offense and convicted him, that conspiracy to corrupt public morals. This is also criticized by H.L.A. Hart. Then H.L.A. Hart again takes up that issue of morality, citizen, that is average right-minded citizen, or the morality of a person standing in jury box. He says that this is a populist model of morality, that is morality of the majority. We are talking about an average person, average citizen, right-minded citizen, or a person standing in the jury box. Basically, you are talking about the popular morality, the popular morality of the majority. When I am saying majority or minority, it doesn't mean religious minority. Minority having different culture, different moral perceptions, or belonging to different ethnic groups. But we are confining here on to the moral perceptions. So this particular idea is based on the majority rights, that the majority has a right to enforce its morals upon the minorities. And then he criticizes the idea of the legislative majority also, that it can do anything whatever it likes. It is not like that. Here you can bring in the point of constitutionalism also. Constitutionalism means the government has got the limited powers and it cannot go beyond that. If it goes beyond that, then it loses its legitimacy. So he's not talking about, H.L.A. Hart is not talking about constitutionalism, but he is attacking the majority also, that majority, if you get in the parliament, it doesn't mean that you can do whatever you like to do. And that means that you can also enforce the morals of the majority. That is not possible and that should not be done. And then he makes a very good argument against the argument of Lord Devlin, that if the the perception, or if it is felt that an activity is intolerable, then it should be addressed. Then he says, Hart denies it, first of all. And then he says that there is no right, or is there any right to protection from being shocked? Do I have a right in the society that I will not be shocked by the activity of somebody else? That if there is something which is happening in my neighbor that is disgusting, then I have a right against that, that I must be protected against that shock or disgusting kind of a thing. So I don't have that right. So that means that if I am living in the society, then I may have different moral perceptions. Some people may have different moral perceptions. They are entitled to have their own perceptions. I may feel disgusted. I may say that it is not tolerable to me, but even then I have no right under Article 14 or 21 or any other human right that I will never be shocked in my society, in my life, or I will not watch or feel, or I will not allow any disgusting activity in my society. That is not there. This is Hart-Devlin controversy. Now I will bring in a lecture, some points which were raised by noted jurist Martha Nussbaum. Martha Nussbaum had given a lecture in NEJS Kolkata in 2015, M.K. Nambiar lecture. M.K. Nambiar lecture in Kolkata. And the heading was disgust or equality. She talks about disgust, that why sexual minorities are being discriminated. There are many reasons for that, but one of them is disgust. Now, disgust is something which cannot be legally addressed. And she says that there is a tension between popular morality and constitutional morality. She quotes Dr. Ambedkar, and Dr. Ambedkar, if you remember, on the eve of adoption of our constitution, he had given a lecture and he talked about the constitutional morality. And when he was talking about constitutional morality, he said that it is to be cultivated. That is, it is not inherent in the society, it is to be cultivated. And that was an attack on popular morality. So on the one side of the spectrum, you have the popular morality, or you may call it social morality, which is based on disgust, revulsion, repugnance, and this cannot be the ground for enforcement by law. And on the other side, you have a constitutional morality. For example, the social morality or the popular morality is prevalent even in the villages now also, is that a girl has no right to choose her partner. Who will choose her partner? The parents will choose her partner. That is under Article 21. But the popular morality is that she can't choose. Under Article 21, she has a right to choose her partner. Under Article 14, she has a right to choose her partner. But because of this popular morality in some pockets of Haryana, Western UP, and other parts of the country, honor killing takes place. Why honor killing takes place? It is because of the tension between popular morality and constitutional morality. We have to recall Article 21 in the public sphere also. Only then we can remove this tension between popular morality and constitutional morality. And nextly, constitutional morality is to be built, it is to be manufactured, it is to be cultivated. That is the basic problem with the sexual minorities when we deal with them. And that is why she refers to Nas Foundation case also, where it was observed that inclusiveness is the central theme of the constitution. Because this lecture was given in 2015. By that time, this Nas Foundation case was overruled in Suresh Kaushal case in 2013. This lecture was delivered before Navtej came. Now I come to directly to NALSA case, because this has fueled this debate on the rights of the sexual minorities. Now, what was given in the NALSA case, and whether that has been really legislated into this Transgender Protection of Rights Act 2019, we will see to that. So starting from NALSA, the first important point of NALSA case, which came NALSA versus Union of India, you must be knowing that, it came in 2014. In that particular case, the most remarkable thing was that the sexual minorities were recognized as third gender. I read some paper in which it was argued why they cannot be recognized as the first gender. I will not go into that, because our constitution through Article 15 and 16 talks about sex. And when we talk about sex, then it is male and female only. But when we talk about gender, then it can be many genders. Then why to call sexual minorities as composing third gender, why not the first gender? But I will not go into that. So the first, the gain of this NALSA case was that they were regarded as third gender. They were declared as third gender for the purpose of enjoying their rights under Part 3 of the Constitution. Then the second thing was that they have a right to decide their self-identified gender. That they will identify their gender, they have a right to declare. That is self-declaration, self-identification of gender. This right was given to them under 2014. Another very remarkable recommendation or the proposition given in NALSA case was that they should be treated as socially and educationally backward classes of citizens, and all kinds of reservation in cases of admission in institutions, educational institutions, I mean, and also for public employments. So they should be regarded, they should be included in OBC or socially and educationally backward classes of citizens, and they should be given reservation in schools, in colleges, in universities, and also in the public employment. Then another recommendation, or you can say direction, was, it should be taken as a direction, not recommendation. The direction was that these people suffer from several sexual health issues. So for that, there should be separate HIV sero and surveillance centers, because they suffer from different kinds of several, you can say, sexual health issues. This was another direction. Another direction was that the governments should address the problems being faced by these people, such as fear, shame, social pressure, depression, suicidal tendencies, social stigma. It is to be addressed by the government. Then another very important direction was that they should be given medical care. A suitable medical care regime must be drafted for them, and there should be separate public toilets also and other facilities. So medical care, then separate public toilets and other related facilities also. Then another important direction was that the governments, basically the central state governments, should frame the social welfare schemes for their betterment. Another direction was that public should be made aware of the plight of these sexual minorities, and their rights should also be enforced, so that if the public know, public knows it very well, because you know they are still under the grasp of social morality. So we have to cultivate this constitutional morality, and if the constitutional morality is to be cultivated, the people are to be made aware of these rights. Only then they can respect them. Then other directions were also given to them, which were relating to betterment of the people. Now, what is the state of affairs after these directions were given by the Supreme Court in NALSA? Then, except Kerala, there may be another state also. I may be not fully, aware of it. Other than Kerala, all the states have failed to implement the policies and rules in place which would legally grant some rights to TG people. Rather, the state governments are trying to frustrate the TG people to change their name and gender in accordance with their self-identified gender. That means the state governments are acting against the directions of the Supreme Court given in NALSA case. Except Kerala and Bihar, no other state has treated these TG people as socially and educationally backward people, citizens, and they have not extended the reservations in cases of admission and in public appointments. That is still a case. Some of the states have formulated the social welfare schemes. They include Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Chhattisgarh, Manipur, Telangana, Andhra Pradesh, but those schemes offer bare minimum, and other states have not done anything about it. So you can say that this NALSA judgment is being not given any heed by the state governments. Now, what was the jurisprudence behind this NALSA judgment? That was right based legal framework which was constructed by NALSA in by the Supreme Court in NALSA. So there are certain points which we may take up. First of all, it was declared very clearly that the gender identity refers to each person's deeply felt internal experience, individual experience of gender, which may not correspond with the sex assigned at birth. So a person was born as male, but here the psychology or in mind, that fellow feels female. Or maybe in between male and female, that is the self-identified gender, not the gender which was, or the sex which was assigned to him at or her at birth. That is the biological sex, you can say. And this expression of gender is given by the people that may be called gender identity, refers to an individual self-identification in the society as a man, as a woman, as a transgender, or as any other identified category. And then court also says that no one shall be forced to undergo any kind of medical procedures as a requirement for legal recognition of their gender identity. That is, if it is put in different blocks, then you should go to one block, and for that you go for a surgical procedure. Nobody will be compelled to that kind of a procedure. And then it was also very well stated in this particular NALSA judgment as a matter of legal framework. Article 14 was also invoked, and it was very clearly stated in this case that discrimination on the ground of sexual orientation or gender identity, it goes against Article 14. It is arbitrary. It is discrimination. Then Article 15 and 16, they use the term sex. Again, in Article 15, the expression sex used in Articles 15 and 16, this expression sex is not just limited to biological sex of male or female, but intended to include people who consider or feel themselves to be neither male or female. So this equality regime was invoked through Article 14, 15, and 16. Then Article 19 also, 19.1a specifically, one's right to expression. So this speech and expression includes to express one's identity, one's gender and identity. So one has a right to express his self-identified gender. And it can be expressed through dress, through words, through actions, through behavior, through personal appearance, choice of dressing. All these are included in Article 19.1a. And if any restriction can be imposed, then that can be imposed only what is governed in Article 19, Clause 2. And Clause 2 doesn't speak about all these things. So that means that if you do not allow, or if the state does not allow anyone, or the society does not allow any TG to express his gender in public, that is also violation of his right to expression under Article 19, Clause 1, Subclause A. So the Supreme Court categorically states that we therefore hold that the values of privacy, self-identity, autonomy, personal integrity are fundamental rights guaranteed to members of the TG community. Now, this brings us to Article 21. Now, Article 21 deals with dignity also. So the recognition of one's gender identity lies at the heart of the fundamental right to dignity. The Supreme Court very clearly stated this, that it lies in the dignity also. So dignity and privacy, they are interconnected. So legal recognition of gender identity is therefore part of right to dignity and freedom guaranteed under the constitution. So who will determine the gender? The person will determine the gender, and when he has a right to determine his or her gender, I can't use his or her because that is also sex specific. That brings us to the issue of personal autonomy. Personal autonomy or self-determination. So from dignity, you move to the personal autonomy and self-determination. That means personal autonomy of whom? Personal autonomy of a person or citizen, because I am using the term personal autonomy, rather used by the Supreme Court. Personal autonomy, what is this person? So Article 14, you know, and 21. Both the articles use the term person. Article 15 and 16 and 19, they use the term citizen. So all these expressions in 14, 15, 16, 19, 21, that is person and citizen, all these expressions which are gender neutral. The term person is gender neutral. The term citizen is gender neutral. They refer to human beings. This is to be accepted. This was also declared in how much time I have?
2 minutes, sir.
You have time.
20 more minutes. You.
24 minutes, sir.
Okay. Now, the issue is not confined to the exercise of the right to choose one's gender or sex. It is not limited to the exercise of choice of gender and sex. It is connected with another issue also, because once a person is allowed to choose his gender or his sex, he becomes a person, then many rights will flow from this choice. Once this choice comes into play, a person is regarded, TG I am talking about, sexual minority I am talking about, is regarded as a person and city or citizen, then the many civil rights will also follow. They will flow out of this kind of recognition. So all the deprivations will go away because participation will come. So there is also deprivation of social and cultural participation, which results into eclipsing their access to education and health services. So gender identification becomes very essential component which is required for enjoying civil rights. Because if this is identified, that you can self-determine, self-identify your gender because you belong to the category of person or citizen, because the person and gender, these two terms are gender neutral. So that means that you are a person. And if that is accepted, then civil rights will follow automatically. Like, for example, right to vote, right to own property, right to marry, right to claim a formal identity through a passport, ration card, driver's license, right to education, right to employment, right to health. So all these things will be accepted, will be available to them. This was NALSA. After NALSA, if you can recall Puttaswamy case, Justice Puttaswamy case, what was the central element of Puttaswamy case was privacy. It was, it revolved around the issue of privacy. And in this Puttaswamy case, Justice Puttaswamy case, very important observation was made. I can read it. Privacy is an intrinsic recognition of heterogeneity of the rights of an individual to be different. Privacy means right to be different. All of us are born as Homo sapiens. This is the biological name of human beings. All are Homo sapiens. Male, female, transgender, LGBT plus, queer, all are Homo sapiens. But we are different. So privacy means recognition of different. That is the right to be different. So that was the basic tenet of Puttaswamy case. And that is why it was also observed that the privacy enables the individual to retain the autonomy of the body and mind. Now, when a baby is born, now what happens that if he is not referring to, I mean, his or her body is not referring to male or female, then a procedure is conducted on him or her without his or her consent. So the court says about that also, that there will be no forceful procedure also. Let him grow, let the child grow, let him determine his her or sex. So the autonomy of body and mind is lost at the time of the birth. So that is also accepted by the court in Puttaswamy. So after Puttaswamy, we can come quickly to Navtej's case also, because Nalsa is reinforced by declaration in Navtej's case. And why I am roping in this Navtej's case is that there the Supreme Court talked about the progressive realization of positive rights and another doctrine of non-regression. What is the progressive realization of positive rights? Realization, progressive realization of positive rights. In A.K. Gopalan case, the Supreme Court said that if we will not look into the procedure, if a person is being denied his right to life and liberty. After 28 years, in Menaka Gandhi, Supreme Court says that procedure should be fair, proper and reasonable if a person is being deprived of his life and liberty. In Golaknath case in 1967, the Supreme Court says fundamental rights cannot be amended. In 65, Sajjan Singh, fundamental rights can be amended. After 2 years, in Golaknath case, fundamental rights cannot be amended. After 6 years, in Keshwanand Bharti case, within 8 years, you can say, after 6 years in Keshwanand Bharti case, Supreme Court again says fundamental rights can be amended, but basic structure cannot be touched, cannot be destroyed. What is it? It is progressive realization of the constitutional framework. So Supreme Court is also getting, you can say, some kind of realization. So the society has to have this progressive realization of positive rights. For example, Dworkin. Now, this is not directly related to this issue of sexual minorities. He says that our understanding of the constitution improves as time goes by. That is, the Supreme Court has also improved its understanding of the constitution. So the positive rights will have a progressive realization. So this progressive realization of positive rights is very important doctrine, and it reminds us why it is so. It reminds us that the constitution is a living and dynamic document. The constitution is breathing, it is living being. So it will move with the society. So as you move, as different generations come, they will pour in their own contents in the constitution. So we the people of India, in the beginning of the constitution, in the preamble, doesn't mean the people who were living in 1949. The people who are here in 2020, they also have some progressive realization of their rights. They have a right to read Article 14, Article 19 and 21 in accordance with their own experience and needs and aspirations. So the doctrine of progressive realization of rights is a natural corollary of the doctrine of non-retrogression. This is very interesting. If you have once realized, you cannot go back. Once you have realized, once we have realized that no person can be deprived of his life and liberty except according to procedure established by law, we cannot go back. This is known as doctrine of non-retrogression. So there is no place for retreat. The society has to march ahead. that was very clearly declared in the Nafti's case. So the attitudes and mentality have to change to accept the distinct identity of individuals of the sexual minorities. Actually, law has one more important function, to educate. Law is education also. Constitution is also to educate. When Dr. Ambedkar talked about the constitutional morality, he was talking about cultivation of constitutional morality in accordance with the norms of the constitution. So the attitudes have to change, the mentality has to change, and when they will change, then we will accept the distinct identity of different individuals. So what is the duty of the citizens? It is the foremost duty of all of us to stand up and speak against all these kinds of discrimination. Then in Nafti's, emphasis was placed on constitutional morality also, right to live with dignity. So if we take all these Nalsa, all these Kuttuswamy and Nafti's cases together, then we find number one, right to self-identity, important. Next, constitutional morality, we have to change. Next, dignity. Dignity of an individual is very important. Out of dignity flows autonomy, and then many civil rights follow. So autonomy is another principle which we get out of it. And if you can refer to George Carta principles, they also speak about all these things. That then under Article 15-16, the reservation, that is also part of the scheme, and then right to privacy, all these things are given. And the sex or gender is fluid. It cannot be boxed. It cannot be related to procreation only. That is not the only purpose of sex. So gender, sexual and gender minorities do not constitute a homogeneous group. There are different people there also, and each and every group has to be accepted. And then right to health is also there, which I had discussed. Oh, I don't have time to go into this legislative history of TG, Protection of Rights Law Act 2019. But if questions come to me, I will refer to it also. Thank you very much. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you for an illuminating lecture, sir. Now, there are a few questions which are raised by the participants, sir. So I request Dr. Rangaswamy, Assistant Professor of Karnataka State Law University's Law School, to kindly raise the questions on behalf of the participants.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your integrated ideas and a very calculated presentation, sir. So you have elaborately covered various things relating to sexual minorities, sir. So there are some questions posed by the participants, sir. So the first question is relating to morality. So the way you analyzed that various facets of that morality in terms of shared morality, constitutional morality, popular morality. So that is unique, sir. So the question is, sir, how to integrate judicial morality, constitutional morality, and popular morality? So that is the question by the participant, sir. Sir, kindly unmute yourself, sir.
Sorry, please repeat it. There's some problem in sound.
Yeah. Sir, the question is relating to constitutional, like morality, sir. So how to integrate that judicial morality, constitutional morality, and popular morality, so far as sexualities are concerned?
Constitutional morality is to be cultivated.
How to integrate with the judicial morality?
There is nothing like judicial morality. Judicial morality, sir, Hart criticizes, and I am with HLA Hart. that yes, it's the function of the judiciary to impose its own morality. Judiciary is talking about constitutional morality also. It is reflected through different decisions, but we may not call it judicial morality. We may call it constitutional morality. And that, the Supreme Court had given directions in the Nalsa case that the public is to be made aware. I am with Dr. Ambedkar that for centuries we were having this social morality. Now this is to be changed, and this can be changed with conscious direction and action only, that we refer to our constitution. Constitution becomes our first book of our behavior and conduct in the society. Only then we can change. It's a kind of a sadhana. It will take time. So if we accept it, that a girl has a right to choose her partner, that has been accepted in Mumbai and various towns, but in some pockets it is still not accepted, but they are accepting. So it will, but what the state can do, at least the state should not allow the discrimination, harassment, violence against sexual minorities or against any category of citizens. So if the state becomes facilitator, becomes a participant in promulgating or cultivating, you can say, this constitutional morality in the society, then it can be cultivated. It is accepted, very well accepted, that there is a difference in social morality. We had Devdasi Pratha, we had Sati Pratha, we have this dowry problem. There are so many social evils, and all these social evils are supported by social morality or sometimes by religion also. Yes, please. Next.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Sir, the second question is, what is the status of sexual minorities in terms of employment?
In terms
of? Whether existing...
Sir. I'm getting echo from your sound. From your side, I'm getting echo. Yes, please go ahead.
Yeah, sir. The question is relating to employment status, sir. Mm-hmm. Like what... status of sexual minorities so far as employment is concerned, mm-hmm. whether existing legal system is matured enough so as to take care of that.
Yes, sir. This is possible. This is very much possible if we employ that mechanism of horizontal reservation. That is also possible. Though Supreme Court talks about treating them as socially and educationally backward classes of citizens, but I believe that if the state wants, it can go for horizontal reservation also. This is possible. There is no doubt about it. If the state, if there is a political will on the side of the, on the part of the state, it can be done.
Sir, the last question is, is there any role to be played by the civil society, organizations?
Definitely. Dr. Ambedkar, when he talked about constitutional morality, basically he was talking about the state also. The government or the persons who will be in charge of the government and the administration or governance, you can say, they have to behave like the servants of the people, not like kings or lords. That is why he talked about constitutional morality. But constitutional morality goes beyond that also. That is in the people also. That is the people have also to conduct their affairs in accordance with the constitutional morality. Honor killing is an attack on constitution. Honor killing is an instance of violating the constitutional morality. So the people have a larger role to play in it, because laws can provide the ground. But when the building is to be constructed, that is society, societal building, if I may call it, then the role of the people and the majority, basically majority has to accept it. So the civil society, no doubt, has a very important role to play in realizing these things and bringing rights to the people belonging to sexual minorities. There is no doubt about it. Okay. Any other question?
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your response, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. May I now request Professor Dr. P. Ishwar Bhatt, Honorable Vice Chancellor of Karnataka State Law University, to kindly speak a few words.
Professor Subir Bhatnagar, I am very happy.
Thank you. I am also happy.
Your participation has added worth to our whole program, because when you have discussed about rights of sexual minorities, you have traced the growth of the whole law by reference to various cases decided under the constitution, and about the concept of morality, constitutional morality. Very clear view has been given by you, that has actually added to clearer understanding of the whole concept. One thing that I wanted to say was that this particular issue of treating the sexual minorities as criminals was prevalent long back under the colonial rule. For the first time it started, and it resulted in an enactment of legislation like a Criminal Tribes Act of 1871. And there is one chapter where it is provided that eunuchs shall be registered, and the eunuchs involved in various types of activities shall be arrested, and of course so many types of hindrances were put, their rights and freedoms were violated only for the reason that they belong to this third gender or eunuchs. But subsequently, after the commencement of the constitution, we come across a passing of this denotification act, then a passing of habitual offenders act, and through certain legal measures, certain efforts were made, but those efforts were not successful at all. It is only when the Nas Foundation judgment of Delhi High Court came with certain propositions that Section 377, which criminalizes the conduct of, position of homosexuals, is unconstitutional. Then the whole change started. Perhaps within just 15 years, or say within last 2 decades, so much of development has taken place that the third gender is given a lot of protection. You have rightly said that the Supreme Court has expanded the rights, progressive realization of rights. And for that, they are making use of Article 14, 19, 21, preambular provision. They go for overarching of various constitutional provisions. And they made a very good contribution. We have to understand the growth of law from the perspective of a social transformation. You have refer to that aspect, how regarding this particular issue, the society has the responsibility. And it was a contemplation of Dr. Ambedkar that constitutional morality is something to be deliberately cultivated. It is not a natural sentiment. It ought to be deliberately cultivated. Thus, there is a role on the part of all the bodies. There is a judiciary, then a state government, and NGOs, civil society, and people at large. That's why in a Shakti Vahini case and other cases, there is an approach that through the strict enforcement of law, by employing the police force, and also by involving the people, the problem relating to Kangaroo Court or Ka Panchayat Court, etc., are to be sternly dealt. That is a very important development that has taken place. You have discussed elaborately about various issues relating to sexual minorities. And of course, it was possible to pinpoint what are the rights of sexual minorities, 1, 2, 3, etc. Of course, it was so clear. I'm really grateful to you. In fact, when we thought that on rights of vulnerable section of the society, there should be a faculty development program. Yes, I suggested that Suvir Bhatnagar is the right person to discuss any of these issues. Of course, during the last 3 decades, I have acquaintance with you, your articles, book review, and various speeches that you have delivered. Actually, exhibit the scholarship, and we really hold that in a great respect. Thank you very much, sir, for your valuable contribution, valuable time. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. It is my honor and a privilege to propose the vote of thanks on behalf of the Karnataka State Law University. I take immense pleasure in extending my sincere thanks to Professor Dr. Subir K. Bhatnagar for his illuminating and enriching lecture for us. Thank you very much, and it was an honor to have you with us today, sir. I also thank all the dignitaries and participants for their attendance and participation. Now,